Thank you, Kelsey. Good afternoon. It's just barely afternoon. This morning, Senate Bill 117 passed the Senate Judiciary Committee. As you may know, Senate Bill 117 is criminal justice legislation that adjusts the 2013 Public Safety Improvement Act. It's fitting because today we're releasing the Public Safety Improvement Act annual report. And so here in the room, we'll have copies of that for you. As you'll see from the annual report, the reforms that were undertaken in 2013 have saved the state dollars. But for that act, there'd be 278 more inmates in prison today, which per inmate would have cost almost $60 a day or $22,000 a year per inmate. We would have also needed to have built a women's prison by now with a $36 million estimated cost. The report also shows, beyond those dollars, it shows the impact of the largest investment in our state's history for drug offenders with drug and alcohol problems. In 2013, before the law, 117 individuals were served in drug or DUI court. Last year, that number was almost tripled, with 350 individuals utilizing drug or DUI courts. Those who complete treatment are staying out of trouble as well. 88% did not commit a felony within a year of release after treatment, so that's good. They're also completing parole and probation in less time because of incentives. You've heard me say before, for every month of perfect compliance, a probationer or parolee can get an equal time a month cut off the end of their supervision period. Overall, the Public Safety Improvement Act is seeing successes working as we intended. Violent offenders who pose a threat are being incarcerated. Nonviolent offenders are receiving treatment. Now, all this being said, the criminal justice system has been burdened with a dramatic increase in meth use, as you all know. Arrests related to meth grew 40% between 2014 and 2015. In the Midwest, the high-intensity drug trafficking area, which is monitored by the federal government, saw a 79% increase in meth seizures between 2013 and 2015. That's in the Midwest trafficking area. So these meth cases are putting a heavy load on the criminal justice system. According to the report, 84% of female inmates and 52% of males are serving time for a nonviolent crime. And drug crime admissions grew from 35% in fiscal year 2015 to 41% in 2016. So, these realities being what they are, the Smart on Crime Task Force met over this past year, 2016, and crafted the package which became Senate Bill 117. I said in the state of the state that we need to stop meth from coming into our state. We need to help those who are addicted and convince citizens, especially our youth, to stay away from meth. So Senate Bill 170 is part of a larger effort that helps address this problem by making needed adjustments to the Public Safety Improvement Act. The bill in particular incentivizes the successful completion of treatment, which we know is helpful in preventing felony arrests subsequently. It also increases training for prosecutors so they understand the benefits of diverting those users into treatment rather than into prison. It focuses supervision resources on high-risk offenders. And as you know, in the budget this year, I've proposed dollars to establish an interstate drug trafficking task force made up of additional highway patrol, DCI agents, and then to expand the HOPE 24/7 probation program to all counties from the pilot counties where it now exists. All these steps, I believe, will strengthen our response to the meth epidemic while helping meth users beat their addiction. So I was very pleased to see Senate Bill 117 pass the first committee, and I'm hopeful of its passage by the legislature. With that, I'll open up for questions about that or anything else that you might want to talk about.
Governor, yesterday in Senate State Affairs, we saw a hoghouse amendment coming from your office on Senate Bill 176, which deals with your authority to act in situations of crisis or emergency.
Yes.
I'm wondering if you can speak to why you think that's necessary, and also speak to some of those enhanced penalties for individuals who trespass and continue to trespass after they've been warned.
Yes. As the pipeline demonstrations in North Dakota continued over the winter and into this year, and at times spiked with violence, I've been in contact with former Governor Dalrymple in 2016, and since then, Governor Burgum in 2017, at least twice with Governor Burgum, and I've tried to learn from them lessons that they wish they would have known, or things, tools they wish they would have had to deal with the violence that they sometimes saw. Most of the demonstrators are peaceful and want to exercise their rightful free speech rights, and we want to encourage the exercise of free speech. But violence, we need to protect people's bodily persons. We need to protect private property from damage. And when vehicles are set on fire and construction workers are threatened, we need to be sure that law and order is maintained for everyone's benefit, for the protection of the demonstrators as well as the construction workers and law enforcement. So. And the county's expressed some concern as well. And so we've been trying to identify what authority the governor already has in statute under the emergency powers. And as you read that statute, it doesn't quite seem to fit a situation like this pipeline protest sort of thing. The bill amends the emergency powers laws to make it clear that when there are certain circumstances, and I thought you'd be asking about this, so I brought along if there is an event that may consume significant public resources, and we know we're in North Dakota, they're dealing with $20 to $30 million of public dollars that have been expended, it poses a threat to public or private property and a threat to health and welfare of the public, then the governor can create this public safety zone. And it has to be posted, and people have to be aware and deliberately violate it to be charged as aggravated trespassers. And the trespass is still a class one misdemeanor, as trespass may be today, but it also provides for a 10-day mandatory minimum. And if one deliberately trespasses into a public safety zone a second time, then they can be charged with a felony. We wanted to create a very simple and plain and easily understandable by the public and by demonstrators. They understand, here's the zone, it's posted. If you enter, it's aggravated trespass. And by providing a very simple and streamlined means to charge, then if you're dealing with mass numbers of people who deliberately act in this way, then prosecutors and defense attorneys both can manage volumes and yet protect people's individual rights at the same time. We also recognize, as was the case in North Dakota, where you have charges that are leveled on a mass scale, that you need to protect people's rights with defense attorneys. And so we gave, this bill would give the Chief Justice the ability to allow out-of-state lawyers to come into South Dakota for a temporary period of time and defend some of these who may be charged. So it's not intended to interfere with anyone's free speech rights. We I believe in the peaceful exercise of one's free speech rights, but it's also intended to protect private property and individuals from danger. And we also want to clarify the ability to stop people from obstructing traffic on roads and causing danger that way, and interfering with the free passage of traffic in both directions.
Is this an anticipation of President Trump sort of greenlighting the Keystone XL pipeline?
It's anticipating the possibility of demonstrations of any sort, but certainly the Keystone XL pipeline would be a likely prompt to these kinds of demonstrations.
The Senate leader said that the Senate would like to see a sunset provision for the entire bill or the scope of the powers. Is that something you're open to?
Sure, that doesn't offend me. I wouldn't be opposed to a sunset.
Do you worry that bringing this legislation could deter individuals who might have an interest in protesting or exercising their free speech?
I'm hoping it reassures them those who want to exercise their free speech rights to know that if there are others who present a danger or who create dangerous situations by their behavior, will be dealt with and make it safer for everyone. I would hope that it would encourage people to feel, I can now go to these areas, exercise my rights without fear, because there's the means to deal with those who might present a threat to me or others.
Do you think the mandatory 10-day penalty is at all strict, stricter than probably for other class one misdemeanors, if I understand it correctly?
Well, it's only, is it too strict? Well, I guess that's probably judged by the eye of the beholder. Certainly we know in North Dakota there were some instances where persons were charged and went straight back to the scene of the crime, if you will, and proceeded to behave as they had been before. And we're trying to interrupt that revolving door of aggressive people being able to continue their aggression again without more than just a very temporary interruption.
Sorry, one point on that, and help me understand, please. With a sentence, they would have to go to trial and everything.
That's right, yeah.
So if they were charged, I apologize for interrupting you.
No, I interrupted you, James. Go ahead. I know what you're saying, though. It's true that a judge may, and very likely will often, grant bond, and there'll be no 10-day sentence. But the judge, when making that determination, looks at the risk of flight and the past pattern of behavior. We've had people in North Dakota from Ohio who were very clearly career criminals, who had previous convictions for aggravated assault, for child endangerment, multiple convictions. And in those kinds of cases, the judge can refuse bond, and the fact that there's the potential of a conviction at a level of 10 days, a mandatory, helps encourage defendants who aren't career miscreants. It helps discourage them from renewing that behavior again, knowing that is out there as a possible conviction sentence.
Can you speak a little bit to the timing of this amendment? Obviously, hog housing, there was concern among Democrats in that committee that they haven't been able to fully read the bill in its amended form and get to know what's in it. So can you just speak a little bit to
that? Sure, and that may be in part my fault. I observed everything that was occurring in North Dakota. Again, this was all happening in our neighboring state, not in South Dakota. The Dakota Access Pipeline construction was complete in South Dakota, so I just didn't foresee that potential for South Dakota. And then President Trump's order, which encourages the renewed interest of the Trans-Canada XL, Keystone XL pipeline, made me realize, oh, if that construction began in South Dakota, this very well could occur right here. And then, as I said, the counties, the Association of Counties, also raised concern because they heard from North Dakota about the problems that county law enforcement were faced with there in, I think it's Morton County. And so, had I been more foresightful, I would have done some of this homework earlier and had this bill ready and introduced with other agency bills or certainly earlier in session. But about 2 weeks ago or so, I knew that this issue had been raised with our office, that, hey, what we need to do something. And then we wanted to try and put something together after consulting with the Attorney General, with lawyers. We consulted with folks in Meade County who are accustomed to dealing with high volume criminal justice surges, which are experienced during the rally. So part of it is, what do we need to do legislatively? Part of what's not seen in this bill is, what do we need to do operationally to manage high volume? Doesn't take more legislation, but it takes planning and foresight. And they're used to doing that on a regular basis in Meade County, not so much in other counties. And so, do I wish we would have been able to put this on the table 3 weeks ago? Yeah. But do I think there's still plenty of time to give it a thorough vetting and get it in the best shape it can be? Oh yeah, there's plenty of time.
I think Democrats have raised some concerns about this bill, and also there have been concerns raised considering the Dakota Access Pipeline protests that it's targeting Native Americans, specifically just by its very nature. How would you respond to that?
I would say if you look at the arrests in North Dakota, most are non-Native arrests. Most of the activists and aggressive persons there are coming from other states. If you look at I think now it's over 600 arrests, 6% are from North Dakota, and maybe 10% are from South Dakota, so 3/4 of the arrests are coming from other states. And they're not predominantly Native American by any means. So this is not directed at any race. This is directed at aggressive activists who threaten other people, regardless of race.
Governor, if we could switch topics to the budget.
Sure.
Now that the numbers have been officially adopted by the Appropriations Committee, and as that process moves forward, how active of a role are you going to play with the legislators to see what gets cut back and how adjustments are made in your budget?
Well, the budget, balancing the budget is the top priority. And of course, we're all disappointed that revenue continues to be quite weak. It makes it much more unlikely to have increases of any appreciable amount, if any at all. Right now, there's no clear plan forward in terms of what we will do to make the budget balance. I've asked the agencies to look at what they can do to find areas that we can either reduce spending or hold spending back. And but as I said, most of the budget for 2018 was concerned with spending increases. And so, will we be able to offer any spending increases at all? I think it's possible we'll have nothing of an increase. But does that mean that people will have to cut as we did in the 2011 session? I don't think so.
Can you talk about the Spearfish Canyon Park and how that's going to shake out this session?
Sure. Well, As you know, I'm sure, we tabled the bill or withdrew the bill for the spearfish canning appropriation. This is one of probably a list of appropriations that are going to have to be foregone this year. Nevertheless, the fact remains that the state already owns a sizable footprint that just was augmented in the last year, or maybe it's 2 years now. And we began a public process designed to solicit public input for the larger footprint if the land exchange occurred. But I think it makes sense to continue that public input for the footprint that exists already. And so we're already into that, and I think it's always good to get more public input, and this is a very organized means to get still more public input. And if it ends up being applied to those properties that we already own only, well, it'll still be useful from that standpoint.
A House committee passed a bill, same bill as last year, on industrial hemp. You had said last year you opposed it. Do you maintain that position?
I still have not seen any good information that indicates hemp is anything more than a chimera. That in fact it's purported to be economic development. I really don't see that occurring anywhere except where state governments are somehow funding research into it or creating industry where none really exists. So I think that is it's something that those who are interested in recreational use use as a door opener and try to create a slippery slope that ends up with medical marijuana and then recreational use, which I don't support. So I'd be no on hemp. Unless someone can demonstrate to me there's truly an industrial demand for it and there's an honest market for it. And I've never seen any of that. People talk about the potential of it, but it's not there that I can see. You might have people who are interested in the marijuana culture buying hemp shirts and hemp t-shirts. And so maybe that's where the market is. And maybe I'm ignorant about that. I'm happy to be educated.
The Senate Health and Human Services Committee yesterday passed Senate Bill 149, which deals with protections for faith-based and religious adoption agencies. Have you taken a look at that bill at all, or have any sense of whether you could support it at this time?
I haven't looked at the language of the bill. I'm more conscious of it, and I'm aware it's had at least one committee hearing. I can see in some ways both sides of that. On one hand, the state contracts with a number of agencies that either license foster adoptive parents or place foster adoptive children, and those groups are accepting dollars that are in part federal dollars, which prohibit discrimination based upon religion or sexual orientation. And so though, regardless of what the state law says, those agencies would continue to be barred from discrimination, whatever the state law may say about their ability to do so. Those other agencies that act in the private sector without any state involvement, they presumably would be able to rely upon the state law. You know, whether that would be constitutional or not, I don't know. I also can't help but observe that we already have a federal law, the Indian Child Welfare Act, which directs the state to consider racial and cultural matters before child placement decisions are made. So this wouldn't be the first time that a government law directs something like that to occur. That being said, I haven't read the language of the bill itself, may not get to my desk. If it does, I'll certainly listen to testimony on both sides and then make a judgment.
I want to go to the phones for a minute. Are there any questions on the phone line? Any other questions in the room?
Governor, in your budget proposal, you set out a 1% increase to education, healthcare, and potentially raises for state employees. Do you think that that is still on the table, or do you think that would be one of the first things potentially to go?
I think a 1% increase is very unlikely. I think a 0% increase is very possible. But balancing the budget's the top priority. One way or another, we're going to balance the budget.
Is there anything that we've brought up or have not brought up that you're watching?
Well, of course, I'm watching all the bills that relate to initiated Measure 22 replacements. And I think there are still quite a few vehicles out there that represent different approaches to campaign finance reform, to ethics or government accountability committee or commissions. And I know leadership and my office are talking about different approaches with both sides of the aisle. And I'm optimistic that we'll have a set of laws that will, at the end of the day, do the things that those voting for initiated Measure 22 wanted done, excluding the campaign finance, public funding of campaign financing, or of campaigns, political campaigns. That won't be, I haven't seen that in anyone's measures, and I don't think it will find its way into any one of them. But otherwise, I think there's a gift limit bill that's finding support from both sides of the aisle already. There's campaign finance reform. There's a couple of, there's a number of amendments that have been already brought into that area. And then, as I say, there's at least two, maybe three versions of an ethics or accountability commission or committee that would do what IM 22 proposed to do.
There's also a number of bills and also a bill to form a legislative task force that looks at the ballot initiative and referendum process. I guess, what are your thoughts on some of those, and could this, is this retaliation to the number of ballot questions that we had in November?
Well, I think there's concern about the number of measures, as I've put it before, crowding our ballot initiated by folks outside the state. I have that concern myself. And so to the extent that there's a group that studies that, I think it's always fine to have open debate and open discussion. And so that is always one good approach, because I've learned myself, sometimes by offering policy without a lot of stakeholder involvement prior to the offer, it's harder to bring people up in terms of their level of knowledge about facts. And in the short time period of a legislative session, there's a lot of issues that are in play. And so trying to raise everyone's level of knowledge about so many different issues is sometimes impossible. So whether it be a Blue Ribbon Task Force on Education or a Smart on Crime Task Force on meth use, a summer study or a task force look at something over a period of time, I think is always worthwhile.
Is your office working with legislators at all on some of the bills that deal with either capping or requiring disclosure of out-of-state groups that contribute to ballot measure committees?
We always have many legislators that will bring a bill or an idea to our office and say, what do you think of this? Would you support it? Would you help us amend it into a form that you would support? And so I would say yes, we are on both sides of the aisle. We discuss with legislators daily those kinds of questions. And in the campaign finance or limiting outside contributions area, we've had conversations along those lines too. All right.
Thanks, guys. Have a good weekend.
Thank you all.
Yeah, happy President's Day.
Oh, I can tell you.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.